Today's Bible passage tells the story of King David, and we think it's roughly around the year 885 BC, so almost 900 years before the birth of Christ. David, as many of us know, is the young shepherd who rises up from lowly beginnings and becomes a hero after killing the giant Goliath. Saul, the first king of Israel, grateful for the killing of Goliath, offers his daughter in marriage to David. Fast forward somewhat, and David becomes the king of all the tribes of Israel. And he conquers Jerusalem, making it the capital of a united Israel. It's an important thing. And this is the scene that we just heard about in the reading, where the Ark of the Covenant, or the Ark of God, is brought into Jerusalem. And David, in his priestly robes, dances with his full heart, soul, and might before the altar of the Lord, in front of everybody, including his wife, Michal, who judges him and scorns him afterwards for his foolishness. In other words, David joyfully and openly prays publicly in his own over-the-top, heartfelt way and doesn't care what onlookers, including his wife, thinks. I first encountered the Ark of the Covenant as a child via Steven Spielberg's film, Indiana Jones movie, Raiders of the Lost Ark. That was the first time I heard about this. And back then, I had no concept of how to pray or how people long ago prayed. But in recent years, I've learned a lot more about early Celtic Christians in particular. And this story that we just heard with the sacrifice and the dancing and the Ark makes a lot more sense to me. I've learned that reliquaries, these wooden boxes, in Scotland they were much smaller. They looked like they were made out of wood and covered in precious metal. They looked like little houses. And they had relics in them, like the bones of St. Columba and things like that. And they would be marched into battle and used in stately affairs, like ordinations of kings and things. The Ark of the Covenant was the highest and most holy of these mobile altars. Even now, it still captures our attention and is depicted not just in movies, but in art, and it pops up in conversation. The Ark of the Covenant, the highest of all these sacred mobile reliquies. It was a chest, wood, made out of wood, and covered in pure gold, topped off with an elaborate golden lid known as the mercy seat. It was 2.5 cubits, just under 4 foot, by 2.5 foot and 2.5 foot. The Ark of the Covenant that David is dancing before contains the stone tablets of the law and a pot of manna and Aaron, the very first high priest's, his rod. High holy mobile altar that acted as a place to talk to God and seek out sacred alignment. There are stories of people dying instantly when they touched the Ark with their bare hands. Also, one time when the Ark was marched into battle, the battle didn't go very well, and the Philistines captured the Ark and they brought it home, and it caused them such bad luck, a plague of rodents and skin tumors, probably the bubonic plague, that they returned it. They were like, we don't want this thing. Going back to David. David is famous for writing many of the Psalms. Perhaps this means that he commissioned them, but most people think it's more likely that he wrote some of them. And in the images of David, like the one on the front of our booklet, he's often pictured with his lyre praying. Psalm 51 in particular is associated with him, and it speaks perfectly to the intriguing story of his love, crime, and marriage to Bathsheba. Let me read about that. This is a book called Living with the Psalms by John Bell. He was the main hymn writer when I lived in the Abbey on Iona. First of all, I'll give you a little bit of Psalm 51. Wash away all my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin. From my birth I have been evil, sinful from the time my mother conceived me. Sprinkle me with hyssop so that I may be cleansed. Wash me and I will be whiter than snow. So King David had committed adultery, and rumors were circulating. He had seen Bathsheba, the wife of one of his most loving and loyal soldiers. He saw Bathsheba taking a rooftop bath. Requesting her presence, he ravished her. I think that means he raped her. Worse, he engineered the death of her husband so that he could add Bathsheba to his growing collection of wives. David subsequently became guilt-ridden and penitent, the more so when the child that Bathsheba bore died to him. How was the king going to express the depth of his guilt to God? And how would the nation know that the leader truly regretted his actions? The situation called for a text that would indicate David's unquestionable penitence. Wash away all my iniquity, cleanse me from my sin. And from my birth I have been evil, sinful from the time my mother conceived me. Sprinkle me with hyssop so that I may be cleansed, and wash me, and I will be whiter than snow. Heard there was a secret verse David played, and it pleased the Lord. But you don't really care for music, do you? Well, it goes like this: the fourth, the fifth, the minor fall, major lift. The baffled king composing, hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Hallelujah. Well, your faith was strong, but you needed proof. And you saw her bathing on the roof, and her beauty in the moonlight overthrew you. She tied you to a kitchen chair, she broke your throne, and cut your hair, and from your lips she drew a hallelujah. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. And you say I took the name in vain, but I don't even know that name, and if I did, well, really, what's it to you? There's a blaze of light in every word. It doesn't matter which you've heard, the broken or the holy. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. I did my best, and I gave too much, I couldn't feel, and I tried to touch. I've told the truth, I didn't come here to fool you. And even though it all went wrong, I'll stand before the Lord in song, with nothing on my lips but hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. David reveals that praying doesn't require a clean report card or a perpetual purity of behavior. It is understood that we will stray from our alignment with love and unity. Jesus clearly says over and over again, the lowest among us are holy. Those that you judge as evil and corrupt are not outside of God's love and grace. Or as I like to say, nothing can fall out of God. But if we think we are right and pure and holy, we puff ourselves up so much that we become divorced from the part of us that is intimately connected with God and intuitively knows how to pray. The Beatitudes teach us that the part of us that is most able to connect with God is our honest, tender human vulnerability. Perhaps our prayers would be strengthened if we said, "O fragile God." The part of us that wakes up when we are frightened, when we've lost safety, stability, and our sense of order, that's the part that knows how to pray with sincerity. And over again, we are told that children, the outsider, the broken, the poor, the powerless, and the ones who don't defend their ego are especially blessed and live closer to God than the rest of us. And we are told that power, money, prestige, piety, righteousness cause us to overinflate ourselves into saved, the holy ones, the Pharisees who act and take great care to do everything according to Scripture. But it's a head thing. They're following a rule book, the ritual. And they mistake that doing things according to the right rules makes them right. Here's Luke 18:10 with a wee translation from Father Richard Rohr. Two men went up to the temple to pray. One a Pharisee and the other a tax collector. The Pharisee stood by himself praying, "God, I thank you that I'm not like those other people, robbers, evildoers, adulterers, even like that tax collector there. I fast twice a week and give a tenth of all I've got." But the tax collector stood at a distance. He would not even look up to heaven and beat his breast and said, "God, have mercy on me, a little shit." That's the Richard Rohr part. "I tell you that this man, rather than the other, went home justified before God. For those who exalt themselves will be humbled, and those who humble themselves will be exalted." And here's the thing about David. He's honest before his God. The Psalms attributed to him are so genuine and authentic. There's a thing that I talk about called metanoia. It's Greek, it means repentance. But it doesn't mean that traditional thing of "you evil sinners," where you've got one finger pointing at the person and three fingers pointing back at you from the pulpit. Doesn't mean that. It means to try on a larger mind, to turn towards righteous action, to try on the Christ mind. That's what metanoia, repentance, should mean. And 12 Steps, that wonderful spirituality of our times, teaches us that transformation starts with being honest with yourself and allowing yourself and all you've done, good and bad, to be seen. David models for us that authenticity and lack of pretense, just like Jesus taught us, that lack of pretense and authenticity are good things for prayer. And that the prayer between you and your God is often so private and intimate an experience that onlookers might not understand, but they don't need to understand. Somebody I've never heard of, William Sloane Coffin, says, "A spiritual person tries to be less godly than deeply human." A gift that I have received as an interfaith minister was witnessing how many people pray. In my training, I got to pray with people and watch people praying from all sorts of different traditions. I was in a mob of people with little candles. They were Hare Krishnas. It was really intense. I got naked with Druids. I observed the Sabbath with Orthodox Jews. I prayed with the living water with a Yoruba priest, Yoruba traditions from Africa. I twirled ecstatically and got nauseous with Sufis. So many weird ways of praying and so many really incredible holy moments that were different to what I know. But the prayers that touched me the most were the ones that were solitary prayers, where the person was privately discoursing with their God, usually whispering while doing something with their hands, like the Native American pipe ceremony, or somebody picking up and tenderly kissing an icon, or wrapping the tefillin, you know, those wee boxes, the Jewish boxes, one on the head and one on the arm that have scripture inside the boxes, talking to your God while doing this with such tenderness and intimacy. Now, in the Protestant tradition, we have the host in the bread and wine, but most people don't get to serve as the priest or the servers. We do have other ways, songs and beautiful poetic prayers that can be spoken with care and beauty and sincerity. But there is something about using the whole body and touch. We were talking about dance earlier, and Dottie was just in Orkney, where there's ancient, the end of the Stone Age stone circles, and you were saying that you imagined people dancing in this. I think of them as places for viewing the stars, but yeah. People danced and prayed. In an audiobook called The Gift of the Blessing, Greg Braden describes a conversation he had with a Tibetan monk. It went like this. Greg Braden asked, "When I see your prayers, what are they doing for you?" The monk replied, "You can't see my prayers. All you can see are the tools that make the prayer happen. The prayer is a feeling, not a thing or a word." Let me say that again. The monk said, "You can't see my prayers. All you can see are the tools that make the prayer happen. The prayer is a feeling and not a thing or a word." Then the monk went on to ask, "What do you do to make your prayers work?" And that's your homework, if you wish to accept it. Is think about, what do you personally do to add reverence and light to your prayers? Let's take a moment. Actually, let's not do it as homework. Let's do it right now. What do we do? Like, say you've got, like, I've got a situation that's heavy on my heart right now. My oldest friend, her daughter, has leukemia. What can I do to make my prayers for this wee girl? Well, I share it with other people so they pray with me. I have a photo of her on my computer. I look at it every day to send light and love. What do you do to make your prayers work? Do you dance?
Not so much anymore.
Not so much anymore.
I just try so hard, but I just fall so short.
We all do. We all fall. Another beautiful way is where more than one gather and to pray in Jesus' name, to invoke Him. Another beautiful way is to say prayers that have been said for hundreds of years, or that are said, like the Serenity Prayer, Prayer of St. Francis.
It's that trust also. We might not ever know the answer.
Absolutely.
It's the trust that we put it out.
Yeah, the trust that we put out. That, yeah. I like to say that all prayers are answered, whether we know it or not. Yeah. Dr. Barbara Holmes, she's great. If you've not come across her, look her up. She says, "You have an inner guide. Listen to it." There are so many ways to pray as a whole person. Through touch, for example, lighting a candle for a loved one. Expressing your prayer through sign language or song or art or dance. There's a lovely church that I visit in North Carolina. It's Episcopal camp called Canoga, and they have a sanctuary, a lovely wooden sanctuary in the middle, and they have the Stations of the Cross that were embroidered tapestry. And I often think about the woman that would have carefully stitched these gruesome scenes of Jesus in his death and torture, and what it was like for them to pray with their hands meticulously in these little tapestries. Another way to pray is actually through acts of service. You know how I sang Leonard Cohen earlier? In one of the last songs he wrote before he died, it is haunting. It's called You Want It Darker. And he sings, a million candles burning for the help that never came. I think about this a lot. And I was thinking about it last night, and I thought, well, what if prayer isn't about God coming to us, but it's instead about us going to God? Didn't Jesus say, I and the Father are one? What if God has no plan to rescue us from our life? What if justice and compassion are ours to do? What if prayer brings the holy into us, a tiny bit each time? The holiness is there, it's a given. Nothing we can ever do will take it away. I'll leave you with that to ponder. And this wonderful sung version of the Shema prayer. The Shema prayer is a Jewish prayer that is said every day. It comes from Deuteronomy. And I find this setting by James Block very helpful. I thought I'd share it with you for our closing prayer. With all my heart, with all my soul, with all my strength, I love you, my Elohim, with everything I am yours. And put your name and set your seal between my eyes and on my hand, over my gate, upon my door. Me and my house, we will be yours. With all my heart, with all my soul, with all my strength, I love you, my Elohim, with everything, I am yours. When I arise and when I walk, when I sit down and when I talk, let your word be in my heart. In every act, set me apart. With all my heart, with all my soul, with all my strength, I love you, my Elohim, with everything, I love you, and I am yours. The ancients teach us that our heart is the seat of prayer and of our wisdom. Our heart is where God dwells within us. It's really important that we take the thoughts of our prayers and find a way to place them in our heart. Thank you for listening.